sometimes called the roof of the world. Tibet is a remote and intensely mountainous region, roughly one-fourth of the landmass of Greater China. With a population of less than 8 million, it is one of the world's most sparsely populated regions, with a unique culture derived in part from ancient and thriving Buddhist traditions. Many major rivers in Asia have their headwaters in the Tibetan Plateau. Much of the history of the region is characterized by political instability via regional warlords, conflicting empires, and external conquest by the Mongols and others. Since 1951, the country has been under the control of China, and debates about Tibetan sovereignty remain contentious, with the country's spiritual leader, the Dalai Lama, living in exile. The prospect of a trek in eastern Tibet had been on my exploration wish list for several years after attending a lecture by Tibetan expert and Buddhist monk Michael Sasso. So when a business trip to China in 2002 coincided with availability of guiding resources, a friend and I packed our bags. We obtained the long list of necessary travel permits and flew to Chengdu, China for a 10-day traverse of high mountain regions between the Yalong and the Yangtze rivers. On arrival in April, we maneuvered through the frenzied streets of Chengdu for a visit to the famous Panda Research Center on the outskirts of town. More than 40 of the 1,000 or more pandas known to exist in China at the time were located at this research center. Next morning, we started an adventurous three-day drive west onto the Tibetan Plateau to the staging point for our trek. The roads were mostly slow and difficult with construction everywhere. As we drove, we discussed Tibetan history as well as Buddhism, which plays an essential role in Tibetan culture. Our guides were deeply knowledgeable about both subjects. Buddhism arrived in Tibet from India following the Silk Road hundreds of years after its establishment in India. The predominant type of Buddhism in Tibet is Tantric Buddhism, which developed in the 8th century. By the 13th century, Tantric Buddhism was a major force in transforming Tibet from a warring state to today's heavily spiritual culture, a land filled with Buddhist compassion, sacred temples and shrines, many monasteries and nunneries, and a great deal of pastoral nomadic life. The signs of Buddhism are everywhere in Tibet. On the afternoon of May 1st, we clattered downhill slowly through endless construction projects on a narrow road to the town of Chakzamka. Here, during our first of several mechanical breakdowns, we walked around town visiting a small temple and playing cards in a streetside cafe with locals. After a two-hour repair stop, we were underway again, only to break down less than 15 minutes later in the darkness just outside of town. Sometime well after midnight, we finally arrived in the small town of Dartsedo and checked into a dingy hotel. The tourism infrastructure in Tibet is virtually non-existent outside of the main city of Lhasa. The next morning, we walked briefly around Dartsedo, where a significant May Day festival was just getting underway. This was our first chance to interact meaningfully with Tibetans. Thank you. late morning, we were on the road again, heading west towards the city of Kanza, with the 7,000-meter Minyekonga Mountains in the distance. Along the way, we made our first visit to a monastery, the Dordrak Monastery of the Nyingma School. As with thousands of other Tibetan monasteries, this structure was largely destroyed during China's Cultural Revolution of the 1960s. Restoration work has been underway for the past 15 years and is very impressive. We watched intricate mural paintings and tedious ceramic figure reconstruction. Murals and icons depict a wide range of figures in Buddhism, and our guides helped us understand some of the complex stories and characters. Leaving Dordrak, we crossed another high pass onto the Tibetan Plateau. It's a stunning sight with elevations averaging more than 10,000 feet across an area 7 times the size of France. For several hours, we drove through mountain-rim bucolic valleys, stopping in a small temple and dealing with more mechanical issues. Upon reaching our hotel, we found that some luggage was missing, including important police travel permits. We slept in a tiny room with an ice-cold shower featuring reddish-black water. The next morning, after settling matters with the police, we drove to Kanza, stopping at several sites, including an important monastery. In Kanza was a long one, and as we walked through town, we found people to be very engaging and intensely curious about Westerners.
Hi. Hi.
Look at this.
Drive that afternoon and evening to our next stop was another brutal one on treacherous roads in extremely bad conditions, including a late-night snowstorm. We arrived around midnight at the dingy truck stop town Manigango. Finally, on May 4th, we arrived at Yilanlatso, a small lake within a nature preserve in the agricultural valley of Rongpatsa. as our 6 yaks and 2 horses were packed with gear. We hiked up to the lake to see the famous stupa shrine and mantra-covered boulders on its shore. A center of attention in the packing process was a reclusive lama named Dorje, who has lived in the Ulaanlaatso area for many years. We heard that nearly 15 of those years were spent in a meditation retreat. Somehow an arrangement was made for the lama to start hiking with us while others finished packing. So we started up the Xenu River Valley with the barefoot monk walking rapidly ahead of us, at times talking to us loudly over his shoulder in Tibetan, and at other times quietly chanting. Along the way, the lama attracted several yak herding children down from the hillsides for brief trailside consultations as we continue to hike up the valley. The lama also stopped to visit with yak herdsmen along the trail, and occasionally we were all invited into their houses.
John? Cooking?
Oh.
And where's you?
Later that day, we were surprised by a snowstorm. We detoured into the warmth of a small hut occupied by the lama's older brother. The brother has a large family and considers himself to be quite well off with over 100 yaks and 3 huts plus a summer nomadic tent. The lama and his brother agree that the older brother is probably happier, but lives a higher stress life without the spiritual and intellectual stimulation of the lama. When the sun emerged, we continued the trek up the valley with the barefoot lama leading the way through the snow, followed now by an entourage of local children. We met additional children as we climbed, mostly girls herding yaks and collecting caterpillar fungus in the mountains. It's a strange but good situation, the kind of unique experience we were looking for in Tibet. By 6 p.m., we reached the campsite and we started to get settled for the evening. It's a beautiful valley rimmed with high snow-covered mountains. But then suddenly another blizzard invaded the valley, driving away the spring scenery and replacing it with a frigid but starkly beautiful winter landscape. We ate quickly and climbed into tents and down bags for some sleep. It was a difficult night with high winds, high altitude, and cold temperatures making it hard to sleep. One of our yaksmen brought tea and hot water to the tent as sun came up, and then I started to hear more voices. Children from nearby huts are stopping to see us again, prompted, we understand, by the fact that few other foreigners have ever traveled through this valley. So we're a big attraction. At breakfast, we hear that a change in plans must be made because the snow is too deep in the pass for the yaks. A new route is planned that will take us into even less familiar territory at a cost of at least a day of extra trekking. We have no choice. After breakfast, many of the girls left in a big group, singing loudly to collect caterpillar fungus on the mountainsides far above us. This fungus called tunsau, worm grass, or gatso gumbu, grass in the summer, worm in the winter, is prized in traditional Chinese medicine as a source of energy, somewhat similar to ginseng. A half kilo of the fungus sells for $1,000 to $2,000 in a small country town such as Manigango, so it's an important source of cash for the nomadic herdsmen in the region. It's a long day of hiking over Pila, a 17,000 foot pass, and down into a spectacular valley with a small stream flowing through a steeply forested canyon. For the next 8 days, our convoy of 6 yaks, 2 horses, 3 yaksmen, 2 guides, and 2 trekkers followed ancient but deserted paths along river valleys, across streams, over mountain passes, through small villages, and past nomadic tents as we traversed a remote range of mountains between the famous Yalong and Yangtze rivers. Many walls of Mani stones with their mantra inscriptions. Some of these walls date back hundreds of years, while others are relatively new. Only occasionally we encountered other travelers. We often saw or heard Tibetans climbing in the mountains around us as they tended yak herds or gathered caterpillar fungus. Tibetans we met on our hikes sometimes offered to sell us items such as jewelry and prayer beads. Several times we walked through larger villages with several dozen houses and agricultural infrastructure, including barley drying and grinding facilities. Breakfasts of rice gruel, pancakes, lunches of bread, tuna fish and vegetables, and dinners of vegetables, pasta and other dishes. And we chewed away at Western power bars to keep our caloric intake high. On two occasions, we visited remote high mountain meditation caves created hundreds of years ago. These caves are used by monks for retreats that may last 3 to 5 years or more. At Tiger's Den Cave near Dzongkha La Pass, we met 7 monks who had been in retreat for 5 years. They were stunned to see Westerners in an area where even locals seldom travel. This hermitage cave was established in the 8th century and is considered one of the most important of 25 power places in eastern Tibet. Later that day, we visited another cave, Crystal Cave, also established by legendary guru Padmasambhava. Here, an ancient monk gave us a tour and served tea. Day of the trek, we woke in another snowstorm and quickly descended through snow and rain past more ancient temples and their usual clutter of prayer flags to the small town of Nezhi, where we were picked up for a drive to the city of Derje. An important stop en route to Derje was the Dzongzhar Monastery, where a 20-day ceremony was underway to honor a protector deity associated with compassion. We were allowed to enter the temple and observe parts of the ceremony, including music and chanting seldom witnessed by outsiders. large and important monastery with over 200 monks. Considerable restoration progress has been made since its destruction in the 1960s, but many earlier structures and surrounding structures still lie in ruins.
Heavy.
Who's next? Dirje, the former capital of an ancient kingdom in this region, we visited a printing press constructed in the 17th century. The printing press continues to be operational and houses the most eclectic and original series of wood block publications in Tibet. We also made our last visit to a temple, this one dedicated to a remarkable 14th century Tibetan engineer, bridge builder, dramatist, and master of Buddhism.
Yeah.
The next day we began our exit from Tibet with a long drive to Jamda and subsequently Chamdo, which hosts the only commercial airport in this region of Tibet. At nearly 15,000 feet, it's said to be one of the world's highest civilian airports.
Oh,
This was another difficult drive over narrow and poorly maintained dirt roads winding through steep mountains. All along the way, we dealt with mechanical breakdowns, traffic jams, livestock obstacles, and other hazards. We saw monks prostrating their way step by step on tough dirt roads all the way to Lhasa, which from this area could easily take a year or so. From Chamdo, we flew to Chengdu and on to Beijing. On this trip, we trekked several hundred kilometers and reached elevations of up to 17,000 feet on ancient pathways through remote mountainous regions, seldom or never before traveled by foreigners. We visited sacred hermitage caves, nomadic huts, traditional villages, and mountains and river valleys of amazing beauty. We drove almost 1,500 kilometers on spectacularly bad roads, sleeping and eating in grim roadside facilities. We learned enough about Tibetan history and Buddhism to better appreciate the unique character of a region that has been largely forbidden and impenetrable for foreigners for centuries.